Security front, we have LRA. LRA is the Lord Resistance Army. It's operating in the south, southwest. This area, bordering Congo, Central African Republic, and Sudan. You know, since the Lord Resistance Army was chased away from Uganda, they found refuge in Congo for obvious reasons, isn't it? Because the government in Congo have very limited capacity to control all the parts of the country, especially in northeastern in the forest. So they found it as an easy way to find their hiding. And so their hideout is in Congo. And from Congo, they create razzias. They go to abduct children in Central African Republic to reconstitute their forces. And we are being told that they are even the former Rwandese who participated in the genocide are joining them. So it's becoming like a regional force, a regional criminal force. And it's creating a lot of havoc in the south there, therefore creating what I'm calling an issue for South Sudan to deal with in this post-referendum situation. Then wealth sharing. The oil, as I said, it contributes by 60% of the revenue in the north and 95% of the new country. So it becomes really something, a matter of death and life for the sustenance of the economies of these two countries. So the negotiations are very hard negotiations, not soft negotiations. And that's the reason why many people interpret the buildup of armies around Abyei, that's yellow spot, is done because they want to do that so that they raise the stakes in the negotiation processes around who takes how much of oil and who takes how much of the waters. The waters of the Nile, you know, there is a structure that was created among the riparian countries, tributaries to the waters of the Nile. This is another issue that South Sudan will deal with, because the Nile passes through South Sudan before going to North Sudan and Egypt. And as you know, Egypt, the water of the Nile is essential for the survival of Egypt. And hence, Egypt was given by a treaty in 1929, gave the Egypt the 85% of the usage of the waters of the Nile. So the monopoly to use 85%. And the other riparian countries, who are 10 countries, will use the remaining. And that 85% were again divided between Egypt and Sudan. And then Sudan had 18%, and the rest, Egypt, remained with it. So anything that touches on waters of the Nile make the Egyptian very nervous. Now, the riparian countries are having pressure for development, pressure to have energy, pressure to feed their people. Twice there have been riots due to food shortage. And those riots now, how do you respond to them if you cannot do irrigation to increase your agricultural product so that people can be fed? So the riparian countries are saying, after all, these waters are coming from us. So it's high time for us to start using it so that we develop ourselves. Is creating huge conflict. And that we are all afraid it may turn up to become a military conflict, because Ethiopia have already said, we fought in the past Egypt and we defeated them. So if they come again, and that's a very recent statement, and if they come again, we are ready to defeat them, because Ethiopia is building a huge dam on the River Nile to increase its electricity productivity. And it wants us to sell electricity to many countries in the region. So the water of the Nile will become a big deal. Then you have sub-sub problems. Inclusiveness and pluralism. The government of the South, who led the transition for the last 6 years, have shown little capacity to integrate other sectors and other forces in the country. So the Dinka, who are the major tribe in South Sudan, have taken a lion's share of the resources, but also the position in the government, to the dissatisfaction of so many other communities who also like to participate in the management of power. And then the human rights respect. There is little respect for human rights by the current government, and it's raising concern that when South Sudan is completely independent, it will create conflict among them itself and become ungovernable. So that's some of the issues. Then we have the whole issue of development. And I'm putting very high on the list of issues of development, managing expectations. This is one of the areas really I hope the South Sudanese will manage well. I was saying to my sister that if I had to write an independence speech for South Sudan, I'll entitle that independence speech "From Blood to Sweat." That's how I'll entitle it. Not "From Blood to Enjoyment," because that's the thinking. They think once they have the independence, everything will fall into place. They will start now enjoying. It's like freedom, it means development at the same time. And so they'll start getting the return of their development. Now I'm saying no. The independence is the beginning of building a country. Then they need to sweat, and sweat seriously, so that their country is built. But for now, there'll be enjoyment. So there's too much expectation. If you see the people who lived in the north, but from South Sudan origin, who are trickling back to South Sudan, those who were in a refugee camp in Kenya are going back to South Sudan. Those who are in diaspora are feeling it's time to go back to South Sudan. They'll feel there is no infrastructure to receive them. The government is still searching itself. There's no money to give them the minimum services. They'll be completely disillusioned. And that's where the fear is. That disillusion can be turned into violence and create more havoc for the South than it is now. So that is part of the things that they need to work on. Poverty. Sudan is one of the poorest countries we have, South Sudan particularly, will be one of the poorest countries we have on earth. In fact, according to the UN, it will be the poorest country. The moment it becomes independent, we'll have the poorest country in the world, will be South Sudan. Now with poverty and all the expectations that I have described and not meeting the basic needs of people create frustration. As you know, you are familiar with Rollo May thinking, when frustration leads to aggression. So there'll be a lot of potential for a lot of conflict going on in that country. The infrastructure, the education, the food security needs to be dealt with. Sudan have lived on handouts for decades for food coming from outside. There is little that is grown from inside. If you go to Juba, the capital city, the tomato that you eat on your table, eating your salad, is coming from either Uganda or Nairobi, Kenya. The vegetables are coming from those countries. Very basic thing, are all coming from outside. It is now time for Sudan to develop a whole plan for its own agriculture and start feeding its own people.